General Audience, we expect that all the press will come here. It's quite an important statement. Because all these times, I think, myself including, we have a fixed mind in the quest of anything happens, particularly in terms of technological things. The cars, they meet an accident anywhere, it will be reported as a human error. They never look into other aspects of it. It's a very unfortunate position. Same thing here, this very great tragedy has happened. So people all find many, many reasons that human beings have done to kill themselves, to destroy themselves and others. So it's a very unfortunate position. That's why I'm very thankful to Professor Raju, who came here yesterday. So he has got the capacity to understand it very carefully, because he being a scientist, he has got his IQ and been his background. CK Raju holds a BSc honors in physics and MSc in mathematics from Mumbai, followed by PhD from Indian Statistical Institute, Calcutta. He played a key role in building India's first supercomputer, Param, and its application in various high-tech areas nationally important, such as the design of satellites. He has written a number of books and research articles which have been published by leading international publishers. His research has consistently received high critical acclaim across three decades. He was awarded the Telesio Galilei Gold Medal in 2010 for correcting an error by Einstein. Einstein is God for a lot of people who are worshipping him as a super, super scientist who has done a lot of things, but he challenged them all. He is listed in various international biological services, such as Who is Who in the World. He has headed India's largest university department of computer science, to over 39,000 students, and single-handedly built industrial commercial software. Apart from fundamental new ideas in mathematics, physics, quantum computing, he has been working in decolonization of education, and is a vice president of Indian Social Science Academy. So this is his background. So unfortunately, he came yesterday for some other purpose, and by incidentally what we are discussing, then we said maybe it's worthwhile. What he said looks the most appropriate, so I decided to hold this press conference. So it doesn't evoke such interest among the people. I hope they will really deal with this. See, here there have been many cases. Fatiman, No, the other one. You did the clearing the path.
The earlier flight.
This we did some time ago. Yeah. It's another press conference. Another press conference, you know, we did it in the what day? April 2011. Sorry. 7th April 2011. Fatigue crack found when Boeing 737 aircraft. We had a press conference on the 7th April. It says fatigue cracks are believed to have caused sudden 3 feet long tear in the fuselage of a Boeing 737-300 Southwest Airlines aircraft resulting in emergency landing on 1st April 2011, Arizona. So this also we mentioned last time. So here too, the position is that, unfortunate position is that we are all being accused of the pilots and all the terrorists and many others, as if people can't think outside that. Outside thinking of human error, they don't think what could have happened with the technology and how this tragedy could have happened. And they are being attacking each other for so long. And we must be very careful in our coming to some conclusions. A lot of inquiry you have no right to talk about it. That is my view. So, gentlemen, that's why we dropped out a statement today to bring to the attention of the people of Malaysia as well as the world to see that they must think and be properly assess, understand it and inquire it and come to a conclusion. And this is not for now only, for the future also, they have to protect everybody. And I got even now a seminar, like one, another one. Today we are having the GM. 15 years, the ignition causing problem. They are hiding for 10 years. Same thing, Toyota. Similarly, there are many things you come forward. You have a lot of information in our hands. So, gentlemen, I read the statement, then you please, after that, you can ask any questions. And Professor Raju is a very well-known person, which I mentioned just now. Are you keeping copy of that or? Okay. So, he was kind enough. By coming to do some other work, he was all made to work on this issue. Because with that, it's very important to clarify this issue. Some neglected issues concerning MH370. The disappearance and crash of MH370 is a very sad incident which has been very much in the news recently. Our hearts go out to the families of the people travelling on the flight, and we feel deeply sorry and concerned about the extraordinary ordeal, emotional ups and downs which they've been subjected. The government of Malaysia has put up enormous efforts determining what has happened and has obtained cooperation of a large number of other countries in this effort. In these days of constant surveillance, where satellites can practically locate a football on the ground, how can a big aircraft with 2,239 people on board just disappear for so many days? The Malaysian government has rightly maintained that the onset of the investigation and in the absence of conclusive evidence, no other inquiry can be closed and variety of possibilities were investigated. The press reports emphasized the possibility of deliberate human involvement. Initially, the suspicion fell on the terrorist angle because two passengers travelling on a fake passports. Then the suspicion shifted to hijacking, possibly even hijacking by hacking into the plane's control system. It was stated that transponders had been deliberately turned off and the plane's course was diverted. Then the possibility was raised that the pilot may have had some devious aims in mind, and this led to an examination of his interest in flight simulators. We feel it is important to ascertain the right course that will determine the future cause of action. If fake passports and terrorism were the cause, security should have been tightened. If the remote hijacking was caused, control system should be redesigned. And if this issue was pilots involved, then more attention should be paid. To the psychological stability of pilots and crews. Accordingly, we feel it is important to point out that the issue of technological failure has been relatively neglected and has remained in the background, although that this has all around been a key possibility. Naturally, if cause of it is technological failure rather than human failure, then it's very unjust to blame the pilot or even the Iranian passengers, which encourage stereotype of Islamic terrorism. Airplanes are designed to be lightweight as possible. Consequently, they have a fragile skin which can and does develop cracks caused by metal fatigue due to repeated compression and decompression. These cracks can be aggravated by corrosion in a hot and humid atmosphere. There are several cases of the older Boeing 737-300 developing cracks has emerged after the well-known case of the Southwest Airline Flight 812 developing a 5-foot hole in the roof on April 1st, 2011. And being forced to make an emergency landing at the military base in Arizona, reporting the International Aero Tribune, 6th April 2011, which is also a short term. Such cracks can cause explosive decompression, the plane in which part the fuselage of the plane may be blown off, as happened, for example, when an 18-foot long portion of the Aloha Airline flight 243 of 2018, a Boeing 737-297, that case oxygen mask worked, and the plane rapidly descended and was able to make an emergency landing with just one fatality. As shown by the same example, despite an explosive decompression, the plane may continue flying and even land safely. It will take time to determine what exactly happened in the case of MH370, and perhaps the full details may never emerge. But given the past history, it is quite possible that something similar might have happened to it. If parts of the plane was blown off, that could well have caused the transponder to fall and plane to lose radio contact. Perhaps the pilot heroically tried to save the plane by turning back and descending quickly to 12,000 feet. Possibly he did not live long enough to complete the maneuvers. Because the oxygen mask may have failed, possibly a change of course happened, the consequence of explosive decompression. Very likely the plane went on to fly on an autopilot mode for several hours and several thousand kilometers until ran out of fuel and crashed into the sea. While this is just a speculation at this stage, it is clearly a very strong possibility. Had anyone deliberately diverted the plane or hijacked it, they would do so for some purpose. It makes no sense that they should keep quiet about it for so long. And this neglected possibility of technological failure deserves to be investigated far more thoroughly than has been done till now. It is important to investigate technology failure as possible. It's a possible since technological failure is a cause, as it has been several cases in the past, that it would entail. Through a thorough check of existing aircraft, these aircraft often continue to be used for as many years as possible to recover the large cost of investment. Technological failure would also raise questions about the design of the aircraft and whether the company concerned knew about this possible defect. See, in the case of General Motors, this is a big case. Yes, they knew the design. They feel there must be an adequate and public investigation into technological failure as a possible cause for disappearance of MH370. Since that might help to prevent repetition of these tragic events, save many lives in the future. Gentlemen, now I leave to Professor Raju. Maybe you need explanation. Mm-hmm. The right person to give all the right explanation. Do you want to say something?
Yeah, maybe I can just summarize what is the scenario. See, there is a pressure difference and there is metal petty. So part of the plane blows off. Now what happens under those circumstances? You are at 35,000 feet. Immediately hypoxia sets in, hypothermia sets in. If you have seen Jack London's story, because those are Arctic temperatures. So somebody gets wet, he has one chance to light a fire. He has to remove his mittens and he has to strike a match. If he fails, he is dead. So at those Arctic temperatures, you get into hypothermia very quickly. So what would he have done, suppose such a thing happened? His natural thing is he has to turn back and come back and try to land. And he has to go down. But the suspicion is he turned back, flight was diverted. Okay, some transponder fails, not because the plane broke apart, but because somebody switched it off. Why does he come down? Not because he wants oxygen, but because he's trying to evade radar. What is this foolish thing? Why should he evade radar and come over land if he wants to evade radar? So these are all the things that are being said. And all that we say is that all possibilities should be investigated, and this must be investigated. It's a very logical course of action for him to follow, that he must come down and he must turn back. So what is, why are they suspecting a pilot who has worked for them for 30 years? and they are not suspecting the Boeing company where the cracks have happened so many times. So all I am saying is everybody is innocent until proved guilty, but that should be thoroughly investigated. That's what the point is being made. It should be thoroughly investigated. Why are we neglecting that? That aspect of the investigation. Why don't we go and look at all the designs and take out all the computers from there and see what all has happened and whether those people knew about these defects? Because they try to make it as lightweight. See, even the laptop, if you try to make it lightweight, you put in fiber and so on and so forth, it becomes lightweight. That extends the range of the aircraft. But it also weakens it. So, and then if you use it for longer, because that increases your profit, you use it for longer. But then that also weakens it because those cracks can develop. So that is the issue. Why are we not looking at that possibility? Why are we saying, oh, it must be blaming, you know, some, it must be Islamic terrorism, all right, the pilot had, what particular objective? I mean, what is more natural for a pilot than to have a flight simulator? He's interested in flying. So what's wrong with it, you know? But this major possibility that the plane broke apart and therefore he made this kind of a maneuver, tried to save it, died in the process, and then it was just you know, sort of if you say, what can I say, it was just a ghost plane which was just going and on its own, and then it eventually crashed. That's a likely possibility, and that should also be investigated. That should not be neglected. That's the point. I'm not saying that definitely happened or so, but it's a very likely possibility. More likely than all the other scenarios that have been put in, so it should be investigated. Yes, you have any questions you have?
Yes. Brought up the issue with the authority.
Pardon me?
Have you brought up this issue, the possibly blind spot to the authority? Any authority that you know, AIT or anyone?
So is it a blind spot?
No,
I have not brought it up. I just mentioned this yesterday in private conversation, and he suggested this should be brought up. So if you see the news reports, the first thing they suggested was that there was structural failure. But then it disappeared from the radar. The possibility of structural failure disappeared from the radar. Why did that happen? That is something very serious. So I have not brought it up to the authorities. I just suggested in private conversation. And he felt it is important that it should be brought up. So we feel that they must investigate this possibility also.
Are you intending to do so? To just to bring up the matter through email or... possibly other...
He can take it up with the authorities. What has been done?
No, we will write to the authorities concerned. We will be right to them. Because it's very peculiar. I've been going through this. Even Nader on the Peshawar cars, 30, 40, 50 years ago, he said, unsafe at any speed. You simply, every time, cause human error. You see, I have always asked, even the police and all, when they go and check the air, accident the motor cars. They can be brake failure, they can be metal fatigue, they can be anything else. They say human error, full stop. It solves every problem. So this is a position. But so yesterday he came to help me on some other issues. I thought it's a very important issue he has been keeping quiet. He should have phoned me 3-4 weeks ago. Unfortunately, many people lost their dear ones, so they feel very very annoyed. So they are attacking Malaysian government, they are attacking everything. I mean, that's not well. I sympathize with them, but unfortunately, it becomes very emotional, unreasoning, this emotion. So you have to reason this emotion. So somebody died, the other day he said nine people. I wrote a letter to all the people. Why this carnage is happening every day in Malaysia?
So the government has done their part,
huh? Definitely. There's nobody, I think it should be very irresponsible to say they didn't do their job. But now you see the peculiar thing is happening. Now everybody directed the attention the other side. So everybody now seriously will look into their passport, they will check everything. And then you go to any plane flight, now everybody will go through a serious investigation.
There is an issue, if you like, of colonial mentality that you are not willing to look at the possibility of wrong design. We are looking at there could be some fault in us, but there cannot be any fault in the technology. That I think is not the best possible attitude. The technological causes of failure should also be investigated very thoroughly.
He is in the right position to say that also, because he is a scientist. He knows about it very well.
Sorry sir, what's your position again? What's your expertise you have?
Sorry, what's the expertise I have?
Yes, yes sir.
I have expertise in high technology. I did something for wing design and so on when I was with CDAC building the supercomputer. I helped to design some of the satellites, Indian satellites that were sent into space. So I have some idea of that. And it is, I think it is, my basic expertise is just in clear thinking. I think that is all that is needed here, that you just think clearly what is happening. It doesn't require a very large amount of sophistication to see what has happened. Some theories have been proposed and those theories don't really hold. You apply, you think scientifically, what fits the data? What is the theory? Which theory best fits the data? And apply that. So, first thing is that structural failure is a very probable cause. Now, why they ruled it out? Because they thought that if there is structural failure, then the plane should have crashed on the spot. But that is not correct. We have examples of the Aloha flight where there was a massive structural failure, 18-foot hole, and the plane flew after that and landed. And only there was only one fatality. So it is not necessary that it should immediately crash out. So somebody may try to save it. So that is what we have said. Yeah. So in the Aloha case, the oxygen masks worked. We don't know what happened in this case because we are assuming that the technology cannot fail, but the technology could have failed because if the plane cracks apart, the oxygen masks can also fail. And if there is no oxygen, then how long can you survive? That's the question. And in that much time, there is no oxygen, there is hypothermia also, as I said, that it's very cold. So how long can they survive? And what would they do under the circumstances? Suppose you were the pilot. See, one of the pilots actually was a smoker, so he would have suffered from hypoxia very early. What would you do? What would a good pilot do? Supposing this happens. He has to turn back. He has to go down. That is what happened. So it's a very logical, reasonable thing. Why say that he went down to escape radar, that is reasonable and this is not reasonable. This is the most natural thing to do. How long would he last? Time to unconsciousness, as they say, how long would it be? It would be a few seconds, it would be a minute. So what if he lost consciousness after that? And it's very difficult to see when you have hypoxia, then you get euphoria, you don't understand what has happened. So that could have very well happened. And this possibility should be investigated, it should be thoroughly investigated, because see, future lives are at stake. If we say, as I say, if you are thinking that there was a terrorist attack, then you have to guard against terrorist attack. But if you think there's a design failure, then this affects so many other flights. So those have to be taken care of, because you don't want it to repeat. So it should be investigated. Okay, there is no definite conclusion, not saying that it is definitely what happened. It is a likely possibility, a very strong candidate, and therefore it should be investigated. It was the first possibility which was raised, but then it disappeared from the radar. It should not disappear from the radar, it should be very much there.
Professor, yeah. Why during the so many hours, nobody on the flyer making such a call? Or so do you think that actually at that time, so many hours, the passenger, they are, have been unconscious?
I think they would all have been dead quite soon, because you see the effect of altitude sickness. When you climb up, okay, even up to 11,000 feet, you feel the effect. Supposing you go by flight to 11,000 feet and get off, let us say in Ladakh, you will immediately fall sick. Now that is 11,000 feet. We are talking about 35,000 feet. If there is no oxygen, they won't survive. Once they are not surviving, the plane is on autopilot. It will keep going until the fuel is exhausted. So it will just keep going on autopilot until the fuel is exhausted. So there is nobody there who is alive on the plane anymore. Right? They would all die very quickly. So that's a possible scenario. And it fits all the facts that we have got. And therefore it should be investigated. And I am not saying that I am the authority to say definitely this is what has happened. No. It's a possibility. And why should this be neglected? Because it can save future lives if we get the right answer. That's the idea. Am I clear?
You were saying that the pilot was very heroic in going to autopilot.
He would have tried to go down. Yes. He turned around immediately. Yeah. So turning around is, you know, somebody has hijacked. Why? If he has to save himself, he will turn around. It's a natural thing. And then he has to go down. And you see, at that time, when you are in such a state of stress, it's an instantaneous reaction. And you don't have more than a few seconds, a minute or so. How long can you hold your nose? Let me ask. It's very difficult to be without oxygen for very long. And you pass off. You become unconscious very quickly. And there's also the effect of temperature. It's very cold.
So when there's the time there's no oxygen, when they climb up or they drop on the...
No, as soon as there is a structural failure, if the oxygen masks don't work, because you assume that the oxygen masks will work, you assume that the technology will work, we are talking about technology failure. Oxygen masks also don't work, then what happens? Then you are without oxygen completely, right? So there would be an instantaneous reaction from the pilot and he would try to save it. And how would he save it? What would he do? Suppose you were the pilot, what would you do? What's the right thing to do? The right thing to do is to turn back. And the right thing to do is to go down. Because you get more oxygen.
In other words, he did the correct thing by coming down to 12,000 feet.
Yeah, so that would be the correct thing to do. So if that is the correct thing to do, why do we say that it was something very peculiar? That's all I am saying. Investigate the possibility that the plane broke apart. Investigate, look at the design issues, look at the structural issues with the existing aircraft and so on.
Do you think the state or the chance to detect the black box?
Yes, black box of course, but what I am saying is we can look into the design of the aircraft, because to make it lightweight, did they compromise on structural stability? When you make it lightweight, you make an aluminium alloy. You are not making it of steel. So steel would be strong, but they use steel only in some places, steel and titanium only in some places. Most of the time it is aluminium. So aluminium does not corrode so fast, but here it can possibly corrode. So once it corrodes, then it can break apart. So you try to make it lighter, you make it also weaker in the process. And that is what has to be investigated, because you want the plane to go further, you want to make it lighter, you want it to work on less fuel, you want it to carry more passengers. And then you come up with a technological solution, but then is that technological solution correct? Will it fail after 10 years? Because the other thing is that once you have purchased the aircraft or whatever, $200 million or $150 million, then you want to continue it. You don't want to dispose it off. No, you want to continue it for 15 years. You want to extract as much as possible from it. And that increases the chance of structural failure. So that has to be investigated. Once again, I repeat, I am not saying this is exactly what happened and I know that it happened. No, I cannot say that as a scientist. I admit I am fallible. Okay, anything is always, it may be wrong, but it is a very likely possibility. It is the most likely possibility from among the possibilities that should be very thoroughly investigated. You are investigating the computer of the pilot, you investigate the computers of the design people also, you know, or investigate what knowledge they have. Because this has happened in the past.
So
you are
saying there is a glaring oversight. Possibility of it,
it was seen initially, it came up, structural thing came up initially, but then it disappeared. People stopped thinking about it and they are only focusing on the human factors. You see, let us look at the passport case. Supposing somebody wants to hijack the plane, why should he use a fake passport if he is going to die anyway? He wants to, he doesn't need a fake passport, you know. His original passport is good enough. So it is not a reasonable thing to say that that could be a possibility. No? And again, the pilot, you have a 30-year record for him. And he has been a very, very solid kind of a pilot with no this thing. So it is not fair to, you check the possibility if you like, but also check the other possibility. Why not check the other possibility? Investigate all possibilities thoroughly. We should not have that colonized mentality that something must be wrong with us. No, there can be nothing wrong from coming from there because the technology has come from somewhere else. That is what should be avoided.
Let me all ask you, why did it turn back?
No, it could have turned back also because of the way it broke apart, but it could also be an action of the pilot. Okay, at this moment, it is a speculation what exactly happened. Both the possibilities are there, both the possibilities have been mentioned. Depending on the way it broke apart, there may have been a torque and so it could turn around. It's a possibility. Alright. Maybe people died instantaneously and it turned around. But it is also possible that they lived for some time, for about a minute or something like that, and they tried to save the plane. So we just look at what is most possible, because at the moment it is only conjecture. We have not even found the debris. How can we say anything is conclusive? There is nothing conclusive. But this is a possibility, and to save future lives, we should investigate the possibility thoroughly. I hope you agree with that.
Mr. Idris, I'd like to share more from the consumer's perspective of airline travel now. What are the lessons you feel that we discussed need to learn following what has happened to MH370? Do you think that the aviation industry has to be reviewed? Do you think the aviation sector?
Definitely, you see, this has been happening all the time. So the question is that they must be strict. Examining the structure, the plane, the safety of the plane and so on. In actual fact, we are fighting on the car. This is the thing there, Mr. Joseph. Every day we are writing to our local press about the car. This is worse than that. Only how many thousand planes are flying all over the world? So they happen here and there. We don't pay attention to this. How do we know? Every day we don't watch how many planes have got in the top. The other day, everyone got fired, isn't it? So this is going on. I understand there are some of the people those days never liked it. They are so frightened to travel by air. See, the boxer and Mumbai in those days, they are so scared to go by plane.
Bring back Chidambaram.
Who?
Bring back Chidambaram.
Bring back Chidambaram.
Bring back the ship.
The ship. Yeah. Sure. You are right.
So, Professor Lazo, you actually are more look on towards the structure failure rather than the human.
Yes.
I am just looking at it to think of, you see, how do you select the right possibility in science? You cannot be sure, but you see what is most probably true. So you start with the simplest possibility and then work towards more complex possibilities. That is the basic rule. Only after you have excluded the simple possibilities, then you examine all kinds of exotic possibilities. So structural failure is a very simple possibility. This happens, has happened in the past. Okay, so that is a possibility which must be considered. The next question we have to ask is, supposing we start with structural failure, is it consistent with all the facts? So if there is structural failure, what will happen? What will the pilot do? So it is natural for him to turn back and go down. What people expected was that if there is structural failure, it would have blown apart at the thing and fallen down at the same moment. So they said, no, the flight turned back. If it turned back, there is something suspicious. Maybe hijackers, maybe terrorists, maybe somebody has hacked the plane's control systems. So they said it turned back. Then they said it went down. Now why did natural thing to go down for oxygen? That's the simplest possibility. Now you remove that simplest possibility and you come up with a more complex possibility that somebody is evading radar. But is that evasion of radar? Why, if somebody wants to evade radar, why should they fly towards land? After the military radar tracked them.
Professor, I'm actually quite amazed. Up till now, the Boeing has not come out any statement. Because whatever you say, your theory is that the structural failure relates very much to the, to the manufacturer.
So all I'm saying is, I was answering his question.
Yeah.
All I am saying is that this is a possibility which fits all the facts. Let us proceed scientifically.
It's a very plausible.
It's a possibility. Yeah. And since it fits all the facts, it explains why the plane turned around, it explains why the plane went down, and then if they died, it explains how the plane kept going in some random direction. So it explains, it fits all the data. So if it fits all the facts that we know, why should we reject it? Why should we find complicated explanations for all the facts? So that is what I am saying, that the correct way to proceed is to start with the simplest possibility and pursue it. And then go to more complex possibilities, and the simplest possibilities don't fit. So as far as I see, the simplest possibility fits all the facts.
Don't you think you should write to Boeing and just inform them maybe they are just...
It is for the government to investigate, and since the government has correctly said...
As a consumer...
They have correctly said...
Personal capacity, you can write to Boeing and just tell them your theory. Why not?
They should investigate such. They should investigate Boeing, they should investigate the design, they should investigate that possibility also. That there is structural failure, did they know about it and what was happening and so on. They should investigate all the possibilities. But so that's a correct position, they should investigate all possibilities.
It is also correct to say, can be stuck, there have been many incidents.
Yes, there have been many incidents in the past.
It's not a new, this is a major.
It was a very puzzling incident because the plane went off in some other direction and the remains were not found. That is what I was. In other cases, either the plane crashed or whatever happened.
If it crashed on the land, things would have been different.
Yes. Because it disappeared, it became very mysterious. It kept flying.
Wow.
Now Uma is suggesting yesterday when we were talking, I gave her an example because the question was that suppose the aircraft suffers this kind of structural failure, how does it keep flying? So one example that I gave was that of a kite. If a kite tears off, it can still keep flying. Have you flown kites? But we have a concrete example of this Aloha Airlines where 18 foot hole was blown off. But it did not stop flying. It flew and it actually landed. And one person was blown off, there was an air hostess who was on her feet, she was blown off and never nothing was found. But all the other passengers were sitting in their seats and they were strapped. And the oxygen masks worked because one part of the plane blew off, it did not affect the oxygen supply. But if the wrong part blew off, that would affect the oxygen supply also.
So in this MH370, you believe that the oxygen mask will not work?
It's a possibility. I am saying it's a possibility. That there could be technological failure. We assume that if it blows up, everything should work. All the emergency systems should work. They can also fail. Right? If that part blows off, where you have an oxygen tank, that can also fail.
They said that oxygen mask can last 15 minutes only.
If it works.
Yeah.
If it works. But suppose the oxygen tank breaks apart.
Even though the oxygen mask can work for 15 minutes, do you think that can last for...
Did it work for 15 minutes? Because you are assuming that your technology will work. They said it will work, therefore it will work. But in this circumstance, the tank itself can break apart, the oxygen supply lines can break. And if they break, there would be no oxygen. So it would not work at all. So that can happen, that's a possibility that can happen.
Tell me, you understand, Chua, you see, when Professor Raju is saying about a structural defect, even a crack in a plane, as he explained, you know, the what decompression is, because this is all very high altitude, you have absolutely no oxygen there. Okay, so within minutes or within seconds, the plane, you know, the whole thing gets decompressed.
But instantaneously, almost instantaneously.
So see, even if the oxygen thing, as he says, falls and there's no oxygen.
It won't fall. You see, what I'm saying, if the oxygen mask is designed for a situation where you have a slow leakage.
Yes.
If there is a slow leakage, it will work. Maybe in this instance where there was a catastrophic decompression, then also it worked. So maybe it will work in that situation, but it need not work in that situation. So we just keep that possibility in mind. And it is a possibility, it's a reasonable possibility, there is nothing far-fetched about it. Absolutely nothing far-fetched about it. So we should investigate the simplest possibilities first and then go to more complex things if they don't work.
think the points have been made.
They have understood that.
So in general, any other clarification, question?
Yeah, you have some questions?
So, have you got any other questions or clarifications? Cynthia, Uma is asking to redo again because some people come late.
Sorry.
Okay.
Yeah, just
what do you do again?
I just give the explanation.
Explanation is basically what you can see is what you want to
Okay, so, are you ready, gentlemen? Those
are you ready? Record?
So you can repeat again.
So I'll just repeat again what has happened. Yeah. Yeah, so the position is very simple. We completely agree with the idea that all possibilities should be investigated. But one very important possibility has not been investigated. Not as thoroughly as all other things, because the focus has been on human error, but very likely there was technologic failure. So if there is explosive decompression, because this aircraft bodies are very lightweight, built of aluminum alloy, and they suffer repeated compression, decompression, and they can break apart because of the pressure difference if it goes into an air pocket, for example. So, because of metal fatigue, and this has happened many times in the past. This has happened many times in the past. This happened in 2011, it happened in 1988, where an 18-foot hole was blown into an aircraft. So, if that happens, what do we expect? The feeling has been that if that happened, the plane must crash immediately, but that's not correct. In this Aloha Airlines case, the pilot was able to control the plane, the oxygen masks worked, and he safely landed it. But in this case, what will the pilot do? He will turn back, because he has to come to Malaysia and he will go down, not to escape radar, but because he wants oxygen. That is the correct thing to do. So if there is structural failure, this is the correct thing to do, and this possibly is what happened. And if this happened, after that, maybe he died very quickly, because the oxygen masks may not have worked. We have to allow for the possibility of technology failure. They say oxygen masks are there, but they will not work under all circumstances. If the brain breaks apart, they are not going to work. If there is a small leak, they may work. But if the plane breaks apart, oxygen masks may not work, the people may die of hypoxia or hypothermia, and then the plane would just continue going on autopilot mode, and it has a lot of fuel, it is a long range aircraft, it can keep going for thousands of kilometers in some direction, and it can then crash when it runs out of fuel. And that is a very likely possibility to have happened, and that has not been sufficiently well investigated. People are talking of terrorist angle, they are talking about pilot involvement, they are investigating his flight simulator, but the possibility that there is a design problem that because they want to design lightweight aircraft, they compromise on the structural issues. They compromise. They are not building it of steel. So they do compromise. Now the belief is that it works, but it may not work. And then you use the aircraft for a long period because it costs an enormous amount, $150 million or $200 million. And when you have invested that much money, you want to get the maximum benefit possible. So you use it for many years, and that leads to higher corrosion. So this is a very likely possibility that should be investigated. That is all we are saying. Not saying it is certain. We are not saying that anybody has been proved to be guilty or anything of that sort. As a scientist, we agree. I mean, I have to accept that I can be wrong at any time. But this should be investigated. It's the simplest possibility. It has not been thoroughly investigated. We are all the time fault lies with Iranian people or something like that. And we have not looked at the simplest possibility. We ought to do that. We ought to investigate it as thoroughly as the other possibilities have been investigated. Okay, I hope I have made the point clear. It's a very good idea that everything should be investigated, but these two should be investigated very thoroughly because future lives are involved. Right? The same accident could repeat. If we don't correctly identify the cause, then the same thing could happen again. If we think terrorists did it when it's a structural fault, and it has happened in the past many times. That's the idea.